Balloons, bazookas, boobies, bosoms, boulders, cans, hooters, knockers, melons, honkers, jugs, rack, tatas, tits, torpedoes, guns, bust, doorknobs, coconuts, and our favorite one, the girls. Welcome to the All About Breastfeeding Show, where your host, Lori, highlights mothers just like yourself and goes beyond the surface questions and digs deep so they share not only their joys and happiness in their daily breastfeeding life, but also their pain and struggles and how they worked through them.
Episode number 195. Welcome to All About Breastfeeding, the place where the girls hang out. I am your host, Lori Jill Eisenstadt, IBCLC, which stands for International Board Certified Lactation Consultant, and I help moms with breastfeeding. And if you'd like to find out more about the products and services that I provide, all you need to do is go to allaboutbreastfeeding.biz. Here in lovely, beautiful, sunny Arizona, school has officially started. So kids who are in public and private schools have all moved past those first few day jitters and are well into settling down in their new classrooms. Teachers have had no choice but to realize, yes, summer vacation is over for them. The highways and roads are actually much busier since school started. Everything seems to be fresh and everything changes as they do with all new beginnings. Here on the All About Breastfeeding Show, it has been a good beginning with the first week of season 6 already over. There's so much for me to talk about and so much news to bring you. It's often hard to choose what I should do first. If you missed the show on the new CDC guidelines, you will definitely want to check out episode number 193 because it talks about your pump parts, the cleaning, and storage guidelines. And how did you like the interview this week with Tom Johnston, father of 8, Army guy, midwife, and IBCLC? This show has been shared by so many that I know it's a really great one. If you missed that show, check out episode number 195. I have been doing a lot of good listening to your feedback these last few weeks. It really helps me to do my best to offer you what you are most interested in. Lactation students and IBCLCs have been telling me they are looking for ways to connect with their peers and to help, support, advocate, and share ideas so we all succeed. So I listened and developed several groups to meet your needs. You have heard me share my excitement about the several groups I'm facilitating. Feedback I've received has given me great insight into what you are looking for. For the listeners who are lactation students and for those who are IBCLCs in private practice or wanting to get a private practice off the ground, you've told me that you really see the benefits participating in the groups and you really want to join. Being part of a study group, spending time with like-minded individuals where you can learn and grow, help and support each other, and be a part of each other's success, well, you definitely see the benefits of that, and it's very attractive to you. However, one of the things I learned is that some people felt a 6-month commitment was a little bit too long. After all, these groups are the first of their kind. You haven't been involved in this before. You've not experienced the immense growth and success that will happen as a member yet. And 6 months was too long. And what did you tell me? 3 months? Well, that felt just about right. I'm so glad I asked for your feedback because the fix was so easy. The groups will now be 3 months, which is exactly what most of your suggestions were. Like I said, a very easy fix. Please go to allaboutmothering.com. If you scroll down the page, you will find links to all the groups that I facilitate, and you're going to see one for students and one for IBCLCs. There's lots more detail there. I'm definitely also listening to all the pregnant and moms who are listeners of this show, who are saying that you want a group too. And some of you are saying you're desperate. Yes, the words I hear you're using are desperate. And I can totally relate, because when I was a first-time mom, I felt really desperate to meet and connect with other mothers and talk about your experiences of pregnancy and new motherhood. And it just wasn't easy for me the first time around. I felt like all the mothers that I would meet at the local park and pool, that everybody put on a nice face and smiled and said things were great and wonderful. And then I would go home and cry, because I would feel like, well, what's wrong with me? Of course I love my baby and I really love being a new mother, but not everything is great and wonderful. I have some anxiety, some fears, some concerns. I'm kind of lonely and I really need other mothers. Well, at allaboutmothering.com, you can scroll on that page and you'll also see the link to the breastfeeding support group. Follow the link and sign up so we can get the next group going. You don't need to be alone or feel alone in this whole new mothering thing. Come and join us. Now on to today's show. Our theme for the next several FAQ days is going to be the Birth Matters series. Where you give birth, how you give birth, when you give birth. It all has an impact on our breastfeeding journey. I'm going to title this Breastfeeding and Birth. It all matters. I've also listened to your feedback about organizing shows in a way that it makes it easier for you to search for specific shows. Now, I've done that. If you go on my website, you will see that there are widgets that will say, well, these are all shows that I've bundled together about tongue ties. These are all shows that I've done when I've had midwives as guests. These are all shows that I've done that postpartum depression is the focus of the show. And I've learned that by organizing shows in such a fashion, like this series, once it's completed, you're going to be able to go to my website and easily see the Birth Matters widget to access all the shows on this particular theme. It's a free resource. It makes it easier to find rather than clicking all over the place to try and find it. And I know what that's like, because I've been on websites myself too, and it's a little bit frustrating trying to find what you need. All right, so our first show in the Birth Matter series, the impact of postpartum hemorrhage on breastfeeding. Postpartum hemorrhage, excessive blood loss within the first 24 hours of birth. This can cause grave complications and even maternal death. Yikes! A subject that many people shy away from talking about. And I think we can all understand why. It's scary stuff. According to the CDC, it is one of the leading complications causing maternal death in the United States, along with pregnancy-related hypertensive disorders and infection. Well, this particular show is not about the details related to this birth complication per se. Rather, I focus on how postpartum hemorrhage can affect breastfeeding. Excessive blood loss after birth, it's managed differently based on the mom's symptoms, her history, and how much blood loss there was. However, as lactation consultants, asking about your birth is a very important part of the work we do, so we can help you the best. There are things that happen during your birth that help to explain why you might be having some breastfeeding challenges, or your baby might be having some challenges. You may have read that it's often recommended to keep your baby skin to skin after birth, allowing your baby easy access to the breast when they're ready to feed. And this is because breastfeeding causes the release of a hormone, oxytocin. You might remember that oxytocin is a very important hormone that you hear a lot about during your pregnancy and preparing for the birth. It is also an important hormone when it comes to breastfeeding too. In the early days and first few days after your baby's born, oxytocin is released when you're breastfeeding. It helps to shrink your uterus back to its normal size after birth. Now, this whole process takes several weeks. However, the sensation of your uterus contracting after birth, which is often called after pains or afterbirth pains, it's felt most during the very early few days of breastfeeding. When you've had your first baby, you feel it, but not so much. The second baby, most of us feel those uterine contractions stronger. With each baby, your uterus is stretched out that much more, and oh my goodness, after my third baby was born, at home, unmedicated birth, the afterbirth pains were so incredibly strong. I swear, if I didn't know any better, it felt like I was going to have another baby. I felt like I needed pain meds just to deal with them. They were so strong, and I didn't even need pain meds to give birth. It's a good thing my midwife had a few tricks up her sleeve to help me deal with those heavy-duty contractions, as it really would have greatly affected my ability to stay in that natural high after the birth and enjoy that first day. In any event, keeping your baby close and breastfeeding, well, this is the single most common way to help control uterine bleeding after a normal, uncomplicated birth. There are extenuating circumstances that could cause postpartum hemorrhage. A few examples: perhaps there's a tear of the uterus, or perhaps part of the placenta was not delivered. If I were to be giving a lesson in postpartum hemorrhage, I would go into much more details about the symptoms, causes, management, and consequences. However, for right now, I'm just going to focus on a common reason why postpartum hemorrhage causes a delay, a low supply, or no supply. Now, how many of you knew that postpartum hemorrhage can cause you to possibly not make milk for your baby? If you said no, you're in good company. Most moms are quite surprised when I tell them this. I'm going to refer to a medical condition called Sheehan syndrome and its effect on the pituitary gland. First, let's talk a little bit about the lovely, very small, pea-sized pituitary gland. It plays a major role in regulating vital body functions. It is often referred to as the body's master gland because it controls the activity of most other hormone-secreting glands. As far as where the pituitary gland is located, it is described as sitting in a place that we call the Turkish saddle, a bony hollow in the base of the skull, underneath the brain, and behind the bridge of the nose. It has two parts, and the posterior pituitary gland is actually part of the brain, and it secretes hormones directly into the bloodstream. The reason this is so important to know is that the pituitary gland produces prolactin, which acts on the breasts to induce milk production. Basically put, you can begin to see that damage to this gland can have a great impact on your milk supply. Now, Sheehan syndrome. What this is a form of shock that can result from severe postpartum hemorrhage and hypertension. In this condition, the mother's blood pressure drops so low that blood fails to circulate to the pituitary gland. This now causes some or all of the cells in the pituitary gland to stop functioning permanently. The mother will have some colostrum in her breasts that have been there by the 20th week or so of pregnancy. Because of the malfunctioning pituitary gland, however, her breasts will not fill with milk. They will remain soft after delivery, and she may not be able to produce any more milk. The damage to the pituitary gland is usually irreversible and may permanently rule out the prospect of making milk. The reason this is so significant is that the severe blood loss or extremely low blood pressure can damage the pituitary gland, destroying hormone-producing tissue, so that the gland, well, it just can't function normally. Sheehan syndrome is spelt S-H-E-E-H-A-N-S, Sheehan syndrome, it's likely to just totally shut down production of prolactin. Severe blood loss can affect the pituitary gland, perhaps causing enough damage to cause a low supply or a delayed supply, but not necessarily no supply. Since Sheehan syndrome is rare, you might be wondering why I'm even bringing it up at all. I want to do all I can to empower mothers to be a partner in their health care. While you are certainly not expected to know all the details and everything that I might know about the study of lactation, there are a few key points you can be aware of if you're suffering from low or no supply. I want you to have just enough information to make the connection so that when you see your lactation consultant or care provider, you will not leave out this important information. I want you to have enough information so that you're not like some of the moms I have met with over the years. They're at home, breastfeeding their baby, with their baby continuing to lose weight, and they have no idea why they're hardly making any milk. They're pumping, taking lots of expensive supplements, drinking so much water that they just feel like they're going to float away. They're eating foods that they think will help to increase supply. They're power pumping. They've seen a few providers, and unfortunately, the connection wasn't made between their severe postpartum blood loss and her supply. In the last 20 years, I've really only met a handful of moms who were diagnosed with Sheehan syndrome. They were actually quite sick and severely fatigued postpartum, which made breastfeeding nearly impossible the first few days and quite difficult while they were getting their strength back. And yet, they were wanting so desperately to breastfeed. They're using every bit of strength they can muster. And sadly, no one has had the conversation with them about the impact their diagnosis has had with breastfeeding. Had they known and worked with an IBCLC, the outcome may have been a little different. Perhaps we could have maximized their time with their baby at the breast. Perhaps we could have avoided severe weight loss. Perhaps we could have avoided mom getting that much more fatigued after the birth. I've met with many, many, many moms who have suffered excessive loss. However, not quite enough blood loss to warrant a transfusion. Amazingly enough, I have to say, some of these moms, they've had birth trauma coupled with excessive blood loss, and yet their bodies, it's like it didn't get the message, and they had no delay in the milk-making department and no problem with volume. And other moms weren't so lucky, and they suffered greatly with these two issues. In every consult that I provide, I always ask about the birth. I want to know how it went. I want to know if there were any complications for mom or for baby. Was there any separation? My probing further will depend on her answers to that question. If the mom tells me about severe blood loss or even mentions postpartum hemorrhage, I will then ask her if she's had a transfusion. If she did, this means that her level of blood loss was out of the range of normal. And this, while perhaps not causing the degree of damage that Sheehan's likely will, it may very well alert me to the fact that her increase in milk volume may be delayed or slow to increase. Knowledge of a transfusion and little to no milk in a mom who, after taking a history and determining that there's no known cause for her lack of milk, well, that information will send me in another direction. All I need for you to know is that excessive blood loss in the immediate postpartum period is something you will definitely want to highlight if your supply is delayed or quite low. You don't need to have suffered a postpartum hemorrhage for this to happen. I also really do want to make the distinction that the blood loss I'm referring to happens within the first 24 hours of having your baby. I'm not referring to lochia, L-O-C-H-I-A, which is normal vaginal bleeding that occurs the first few weeks after the birth. The amount tends to be heavier the first few days and begins to taper off the second and third week. I am purposely not detailing volume or color, as this could vary from mother to mother based on many things. What is most important for you is to be aware of this distinction. It's my job to be observant and ask the right questions. As an IBCLC, I need your help in providing accurate information so that I can think clearly about all the possible reasons for causing the problems that you came to see me about. All right, well, this has been a pretty heavy show, and I thought that I would like to end it by lightening things up a little bit and have a little mom humor from some pins that I found on Pinterest. I hope you have a pretty good sense of humor about life, babies, birth, and breastfeeding. If these are not for you, or if this is not your kind of humor, apologies ahead of time. So I was looking at some of the pins, and I'm going to ask you to think about this. How many of these sayings has your mother used with you? And what I want to know is, if you have children, have you used them with your kids? So I'm going to tell you what this saying is, and then I'm going to be pretty, you know, just I'm just going to tell you like it is in my household. So let's start with number one, which is, because I said so, that's why. Well, this is probably the first thing that I swore I would never say, but it's probably the first thing that I repeated. Number two, I don't know is not an answer. No, I don't really say that to my kids. Number three, eat your vegetables. No, I didn't really say that to them either. Number four, beds are for sleeping in, not jumping on. No, I didn't really say that to my kids either. But number five, I said this a lot. No one said life is fair. Guilty as charged. I said that way too many times, probably. Number six, your hands are not broken. No, I didn't really use that one. Seven, your face is going to freeze like that. No, I didn't really say that to my kids. Number eight, wait until your father gets home. Oh yeah, wait until daddy gets home was probably way overused in my household. Number nine, I don't care who started it. Oh yeah, 1,000 times yes. That was a big part of probably my daily vocabulary. Number 10, what part of no don't you understand? Well, I am embarrassed, but the truth is, oh yeah, that was also said thousands of times probably in all the years of raising kids. All right, next on my list of some fun parenting humor, how long do you think it is going to take until you find yourself saying these kinds of things to your kids? One of the first things I saw on Pinterest and some of the little cartoons, the humorous cartoons, well, one of them said, you never know how many people you don't like until it's time to name your baby. Now, I never really thought much about it in this way, but it's so true. Does that resonate with anybody? And there was another cartoon said with a mom, I'm just a girl stuck under a sleeping child with a full bladder and a dying phone. Hashtag mom life. Then there was another one that really struck me as funny. It said, do you want some time alone? Well, I highly suggest you tell your kids to clean up. They won't do it, but they will disappear and leave you alone for a few minutes, which is exactly what you wanted. Now, when I read that, I'm like, why didn't I ever think of that? All right, I think I've done my job today. I've educated you on a pretty scary topic. I informed you about this really hard subject, but I'm leaving you feeling lighthearted and hopefully with a smile on your face. I am so glad you stuck around to the end, so I can say, until the next show, bye-bye.